Hello one and all, and welcome to a thankful edition of the Brewing Labs. Now, this video is actually coming out coincidentally on the week of Thanksgiving, and I do have to admit this year is going to be very awkward for a lot of people for the holiday due to, well, current events, for lack of a better word. So I decided to actually thought of a fun kind of like going back to kind of like a comfort deck of mine and actually tweaking it with a energetic overhaul, so to speak. Now, one of my comfort decks that I actually play during in Standard, as well as a little bit in Historic once in a while, is actually Jug Food. Many people know this archetype. It's pretty much the combo with Cauldron Familiar, as well as Witch's Oven. You sack, you pretty much bring it back. Boop, 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 boop. Now, granted, this combo does get a little bit negative if somebody was smart enough to main board, say, for example, a Graft Digger's Cage, but overall, the combo's still fun to play. So I decided to actually update this deck because it's kind of fun with a card that most people forget about. Well, actually, not many people are forgetting about it now since it's actually a very popular card. A Force Marvel. One of my favorite cards from the Kaladesh block, personally. A 4-mana artifact, legendary artifact. Whenever a permanent you control is put into a graveyard, you get energy, and you can pay 6 energy to look at the top 6 cards of your library, and you may cast a spell from among them without paying its mana cost, and then you put the rest in the bottom of the library in a random order. Now, funny story with this card. I know what many people are thinking when they look at this card. It's like, oh, I mean, I know this card. In Standard, it was just used for try to roll the die, try to get a cheap Ulamog, and just win the game like that. And yes, a lot of people within the Historic format are pretty much trying to do the same thing. They're trying to pretty much either do teamer or variety of variations of this archetype to mostly try to get Ulamog as soon as they can. For me, though, when I played with this card, actually, my favorite use of this card wasn't for that instant win kind of scenario. It's actually mostly to use as an engine of sorts. Which, granted, it looks like an engine, so why not? But anyway, one of my original iteration, like, janky brew decks I brewed in Standard long, long while ago, was actually using Aetherwood's Marvel with, of all things, the cartouches. And kind of the cartouches as well as the trial cycle. Mostly it's because it's one of those scenes where auras kind of have that detrimental ability that even though the auras of the cartouches were really good because they did have a good ETB trigger, they do still have the factor that you can get 2-for-1. Well, thanks to Aetherwood's Marvel, you actually get the benefit of those multiple permanents going to the graveyard, which then generates multiple energy. Okay, that was a little sidetrack there, but it kind of gets to the point of how this deck is going to work. The factor is, we have a lot of sack outlets and recursion sack outlets, like the classic Cauldron Familiar Witch's Oven combo. Which the reason why I put a 2 and 3 in this list is mostly just because so we can have enough room to actually put in the Wood Leaver's Puzzle Knot, as well as the Aetherwood's Marvel. But the basic gist is, since we are constantly going to do the cat thing, where it's like the cat dance, boop 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 boop, we're going to have constantly permanents going into our graveyard. And since permanents are constantly going to be going into our graveyard, we can actually fuel and get energy. Now, we do have some late-game payoffs, but they're not as absurd as, say, like an Ulamog and such. They're just good cards in general. And the thing about the one con with the Ulamog deck is when you roll the die, so to speak, you usually just want to get Ulamog or a good late-game bomb. If you don't, then it kind of feels Well, thanks to kind of like how Jund Sacrifice works, we have a lot of cards we don't mind to get early game as well as late game. Such as the Cauldron Familiar, as I mentioned before. We could also get a Trail Clums. Heck, there's even sometimes where you get a Fatal Push and you don't mind it whatsoever. Or even any of our early game combo pieces, but we do have some late game stuff that we do want to try to get. We have Razaketh, which Razaketh's just really good in Sacrifice Matter deck archetypes because, well, it's Tutor by sacking, which is really good for our deck. We also have Turn Teamer Symbiosis, kind of a theme that I learned from the Teamer archetypes, essentially, if you want to try to tutor for more creatures. This is another cheat spell you can get, as well as Mariette Master. This is actually a combo I actually saw from Elias when she did the Gagari Food deck, essentially. Her implementation was essentially doing the cat dance as well, but Mariette Master is actually a payoff, because what you do is essentially you have Mariette Master on the battlefield. And then when you do the combo, when you sacrifice food to return the cat, then essentially you will drain your opponent using Marionette Master, which is actually a really cool combo, and I kind of decided to put it in as a one-up just because that's a really neat late-game payoff. We also throw in Liliana Dreadhorde General, just good in sacrifice mana based decks because of her static effect as well. She's a very powerful planeswalker in Historic. We also have Demon of Dark Schemes as an experimental card in the deck, mostly just because I wanted to test it out, because we're constantly going to have permanents die, we're going to get energy, and we might have ways to kill creatures with Mayhem Devil triggers, etc, etc, etc. So then we're going to constantly generate energy from that. Plus the activated ability of being able to pay for energy and take a nice creature in our graveyard or the opponent's graveyard and go, bidoop. Very, very nice. We also put in Kolvald, which just makes sense in Jund Sack in general. We also have Vivian's Monster's Advocate in here just because it's just a great card, especially since we're mostly a creature-oriented deck design. Being able to play creatures on top of our graveyard and tutor for specific creatures, which kind of like Jund Fu, you want to get very specific creatures out to get the combo going. So that's actually really nice in the deck. We also put in one all-star that I would say that even if you don't go with the energy-based archetype, one card I absolutely recommend if you play Jund Fu in Historic, you really gotta try Witch of the Moors. Witch of the Moors is so good. I mean, the fact is, if we're going to be constantly doing the Cauldron Cat Dance scenario and we're going to gain life constantly, we can even just gain life by just eating food in general. So being able to instep if we gain life, making our opponent forced to sacrifice a creature, as well as return up to one target creature. And like we said, we do have a bit of combo shenanigans, so it's good that we get return key creature cards from our graveyard to our hand. It's just an amazing card for the deck. Averroes Marvel, we talked about it. Vraska, just a good card in Jund Sacrifice. I see people playing usually two. I'm just playing one in the deck, mostly just so that we can have enough room for this. We're also trying out Kell's Fight Fencer, which it's kind of like a Kolvald Light that can also be used as a sacrificial sack, can use to help fuel sack essentially. That's basic for okay, that did not make sense in English. In other words, it's I always get confused when I say sack outlets. It's a sack outlet. We can spend mana, sack something, and if we sack something, we could spend black mana to essentially draw a card, which is nice. We also have Mayhem Devil, just a perfect card in the Jund sack. Just every time we sack something, we pain our opponent. Or ping opponent's permanent. Very nice. Well, other than the lands, but you get my shtick. Then also another auto-include I would say in Jund Sack to give a shot at least one or two of. Try Yhenny Undying Partisan. Really silly because it is kind of like the... It does the purpose of mostly what Wellstrider does where it's a sack outlet that's free. But Yhenny also just have the benefit of just being a very aggressive-oriented creature that once you kill your opponent's creatures, it gets bigger. You can keep it indestructible. It's just really silly. Plus, if you get this really big and you are in later in the game where you can't really attack in, you could just sack this and then just get a ton of food from it. Well, two food, but you get my shtick. We're also throwing in two Soul Shatters. Just mostly it's our way to answer Planeswalkers as well as really big creatures. Pretty much hexproof creatures. Plus also the factor that sacrifices. It's synergized with our Mayhem Devil, so that's nice. We're also throwing Woodweaver's Postmont, which surprisingly is synergistic in this deck, which is a weird thing to say. Sure, the ETB doesn't matter, but you do have to sack to get the secondary effect on it, and yet again, we have sacrifice mana triggers, so we have a Kolvald out, we sack this, we get the Kolvald trigger, and stuff like that. It's kind of like a weird semi-synergy in the deck. And then, of course, one of the other main components of Jund Sack is just Trial of Crumbs, just generate food, and then anytime we sack food, just being able to look at the top two cards of our library if we pay one mana and be able to get a permanent out of it. This is our semi-card draw in the deck, and it just works perfectly. And of course, we gotta throw in the Gilded Goose. Helps us generate food, helps us essentially be a one mana dork to get into some really good turn three plays, and just a constant generator of food, mostly, to help us sack so that we can have synergies. Plus, hey, you either are going to get turkey on Thanksgiving, or ham, or the rare case you get goose. Okay, that joke was a little cheesy, but you get my shtick. Anyway, that is the deck. We are going to play a few matches in Historic just to show kind of like how it is, and see what shenanigans that we can do with some energetic food, shall we? Ba-ding! That's a peculiar username. Now, you know what someone who did this username either thought they were a comedian, or they were really tired that day. It's either one or the other. Okay, we have a pretty decent hand here. We have Cauldron Familiar, Trail of Crumbs, Ecklewitz Marvel, Vivian. We just need to get, like, our Witch's Oven, and we should be good to go. Nevertheless, just a good start, so we're gonna keep this hand. Also, we throw in, other than your typical Jun mana base, we do throw a Phyrexian Tower in here as a one-of, just because, well, it's a sacrifice outlet, as well as just a good ramp target if we want to ramp into a Marvel early, so... Actually, we could probably get the Marvel out by turn two, which is kind of surprising to say. Okay, so, we're gonna play this turn one. We're gonna play Gap. Okay, so the fact that our opponent's playing Sheltered tells me that they're playing a control deck of some sort. Because usually you only play this when you want to protect specific permanents, or maybe they're just testing it out. So we do get the Witch's Oven here, which is nice, but what I think we're going to do here is do the Kabina, as I mentioned before. We're actually going to sacrifice this. That gives us 3 mana, which then gives us enough mana to do Trail of Crumbs and the Kick, or the Witch's Oven to fuel the Cat Shenanigans. Now we're going to wait till next turn to bring it back, but you kind of see where we're going with this. So our opponent's playing Esper. They're going to do some anticipation. I'm kind of tempted to return when we return this back to actually not do the Trail of Crumbs trigger and actually try to ramp into an Ecklewitz Marvel early. Because the way I'm looking at it is we have Vivian's Advocate in a few turns, so we could. Call this kind of like the experimental. Let's see what happens. So then now we can play Ecklewitz Marvel. And then in 2 turns we can play Vivian and then just use that as a sac outlet and generate energy constantly. Also, Ecklewitz Marvel can have a target on its head, so maybe if they have like a path that, well, kind of like a Conclave Tribunal or any like Oblivion Ring removal effects, it's better that we get Ecklewitz Marvel out and make opponents think like, oh, that's probably their primary card. I better remove that as soon as possible. You know, stuff like that. And looking up, we got a second one, just in case if our opponent decides to remove it. But for now, we're just going to put this in tap. I don't really need to draw a card at the moment, so especially I don't want to lose the life at the moment. And it looks like our opponent's just holding up a counter magic. So I'm going to try to play any and see if we can fish it out. There we go. So it looks like they're mill deck. Or they just have that as their counter magic in the deck. Okay, so no Phyrexian Tower shenanigans. Got your opponent. This feels like a Yorion deck or a Doom Foretold deck, because usually Doom Foretold decks are the ones that play cards like Witch for Flight. Which, honestly, for us playing Jun Sack, that's actually really good. But, it depends. Or our opponent is playing really Bunny Jake. I can agree with that. Looks like there's a go here. Perfect. So we're just going to create a little beast token with Reach just in case.
I call, and Ikoria answers.
And we're just going to hold it up as a chunk blocker unless they try to remove it. Then we're going to sack it for food and such, so... Ah, Scare of God. Oh, oh dear, Scare of God. Okay, so we're going to sacrifice this. And since it's still a token and it's from the graveyard, we still get energy. That's one of the secondary reasons why we have Vivian in the deck. Because it generates tokens, which the tokens generation is actually pretty nice. So we generate 2 energy from that play, which is nice. Honestly, I think we're just going to create another beast token. again. Pick that breach again, just to be safe.
I'd like you to meet
and
my friend.
Honestly, we just pass the turn and see where our opponent tries to be. We gotta be cautious, because they can try to remove our stuff and activate the Scarab God trigger, so we gotta be very, very cautious about that. So our opponent's just going to block with that. That makes sense. We'll block with this. Because mostly that's what the beast tokens are going to be at the moment. They're just going to be... I figured that was going to happen. Kind of surprised they didn't did that before combat if they were going to do that. Because the haste would have actually gave them a better combat advantage. Let's see, it's 4 mana to activate that ability. It does make the Yahini be bigger, so we are in a bit of a pickle, one could say. Anyway, we're gonna do the dance. That's also one con of it. Since they have the Yahini, it's going to get bigger with every trigger of our cat dance, which is a little problematic, one could say. This because we're gonna play the goose. And then we're just going to draw a card. We're gonna lose a little bit of life with that, but that's mostly because we have a fatal push here. And we get a fatal push this. Mostly the reason why we're doing this is because if we have any other method of removal, then they're forced to attack Scarab God if they want to keep this. At least that's the plan. We could play this as a land and then play this in tutor for something. I think that's the play actually. So we're gonna play this as a land. We're gonna lose 2 life. We're gonna minus 2 on the Vivian.
I hope things get out of hand.
I think I goofed on the map there.
I brought friends.
Wait, did I? Oh, it's 8 mana. Decline. And that's what we call an accidental misplay, everybody. Okay, plan B. What's going to be dance? Yeah, I know, your hitting gets bigger. We know. Still a lot of energy. We're gonna activate that energy to actually get Kraska. Do we want anything else? Actually, yeah, we would want a Liliana. That's a lot better in this circumstances. We're gonna use it to
my
sacrifice
army will envelop this world.
Permanents that way.
Back to shambles.
Technically, Scarab God's gonna go back to their hand. We don't mind that though. We're just mostly wanting to get it out of the battlefield. And then we get a Wood Weaver's Pokemon, which is nice. And we're kinda on the metaphorical play. I mean, they can still replay it, but it's gonna cost the mana to replay it, so. Interesting that they're the same. Not the same. We're gonna get a second trail of crumbs. No sweat of running. And then we're going to get some more energy thanks to the puzzle knot. So then next turn, we can spin the wheel. Okay, let us... Actually... I'm curious about something. This is not the play to do, but I'm kind of curious what happens if we can get a creature from a forward marble if it's considered a zero-cost creature since you're casting it for free. This is more like an experiment. Honestly, the better play here is just to cast the Prazaketh and then essentially get the trigger, which then allows us to tutor for any card in our deck, but mostly I'm just curious to see how this works. Does our opponent have, like, a stifle effect? Okay, yeah, the stifle effect. Okay, I got you now. Well, well, I guess in plan B.
My herd grows ever larger. Good mindless minion.
Get a little bit of food from that. Thank you, kind of opponent.
Waste not, want not.
Now, technically, it would probably have been better for them to lose 8 life from that, but... I'd rather get the food. Now, the one thing we do have to be cautious is that they can reanimate it from the graveyard. You see, Spirit God, and the opponent was like, it's Thunder Rally to the Pepper. Okay, let's play one more round of this just to skip the suite of things, but like I said, it's basically junk food and we throw a Fort's Marble in it. Nothing more, nothing less, but hey. Sometimes during the holidays, you just gotta get back to kind of like things, you know, your comforts. And this is definitely an archetype that is fun for me, so. Okay. We'll give this hand a shot, though it's not the best hand in the world. I'm just gonna say that right off the bat. And apparently, we're going against an MTG Arena player. Okie dokie. Let's see what they did. Looks like there's a little bit of swamps in their shenanigans. We're gonna numb on some food. Looks like the Orzhov life game deck. Okay. We could just... Yeah, I'm kinda tempted to play the second one. That way then we can just sacrifice. Since we only have this to play on turn 4, which is really, you don't really want to play this on turn 4 unless you have a sacrifice outlet, which you don't have at the moment, about the creature variety. Oh, it's Abzan! I would rather just sacrifice the food and then just essentially trigger on the Trail of Crumbs. So, we're gonna do just that. Get some life, do both these, refill our hand with some permanents. And I'll take a castle. And, ooh, this one's a hard one. I think we take the Henny. The next turn, we'll just play Vivian's Monster's Advocate, just because it's a good card. And then we can just play Yehenny to sacrifice whatever tokens we generate from Vivian. Okay, this is like a cleric deck, is my guess. Yeah, cleric. Absent clerics, it looks like is the case, which kind of makes sense because there is also that one from Paris Beyond Death that works as a reanimate that pretty much returns a target permanent from your graveyard. So Architect makes sense, is what I'm saying. So we're just gonna create a beast. We're gonna give it reach since some clerics do have line, and they might be going into the full party deck shenanigans, so that they might be running some flyers of some sort. Yet again, a little odd choice, but it makes sense. And boy, do we need a Mayhem Devil now.
Okay, what do we do?
Oh wait, now I know what we do. Okay, here's what we do. What am I doing?
I brought friends. Lots.
We're going to cast Death,
my herd grows,
which
ever
then
large.
Allows us to tutor for the Mayhem Devil. Oh my. So then we can activate it. We're not going to get any of the E triggers or the Trail Crumb triggers, but we are going to keep Scoot Swarm a little bit in check. Because we do not want to get that big. Or do we? You could make an argument that now that we know that we have Demon of Dark Schemes on the top of our deck, that it might be practical for us for them to go a little nutty with this. And thus we get a lot of energy from it. Well, at least we have the Soul Shatter on top, just to be safe. Now, one thing you want to keep in mind with this, remember that, like, stuff like this, you don't want to try to Trail Crumbs it since it's not a permanent spell, so we don't want to do that. But what we could do here is... Oh, I got it. We're going to play Yin. We're going to sacrifice our reach to give it that. Then that allows us to just peen and... Actually, we're just going to paint him in the face, so we know we have the Demon of Dark Schemes. Then we can play this to draw this card. We can play this untapped. Since it's the highest cost permanent, we can Soul Shatter it and just remove it so that we don't have to deal with it. That allows us to paint it. We're just going to bend the paint this and keep it in check. Plus, also, it helps us make Yhini bigger, which is nice. We're going to give it to you still, just to be safe.
We will adapt to any threat.
And Kells and Yhini surprisingly are very synergistic with one another, just being able to have a unconditional sack outlet. Also, said the same thing goes with Well Shredder too, obviously, so being able to just have the synergy where you can sack for free, and then the mana you would save from that, you could use it to draw a card. Very nice. Speaking of drawing cards, it looks like that's what our opponent's doing. I know this looks weird, but like I said before, we do have the Demon of Dark Scheme, so if they are just going to try to get a lot of bugs on the battlefield, that's going to be a lot more beneficial for us in the long run. Especially since the majority of our permanents are in the... Okay, yeah, now we're seeing what they're doing. It's cute. But yeah, like I said, we do have the play here, so we're going to play the Demon of Dark Scheme. That's going to get rid of those bugs. That's going to give us some energy. That's going to make Yhini a little bit big, one could say. Then one plus. Create another one with reach.
I love making.
We're just going to sacrifice the one that doesn't have it. That way, then, we get a trigger here to beat this. And our opponent realizes that we were going to beat the board himself. Very nice. Very nice. the shenanigans. And yeah, that's kind of at least a short video of the Jund Sack deck. I'll provide a deck list below in the captions and such. I hope you kind of enjoyed the shenanigans. I don't know how the holidays are going to be for you, so I just hope you have whatever holiday you celebrate, whether it's Thanksgiving or whatever it's after Thanksgiving and such. I hope you have a happy holidays. I hope you can just... I know current events is making everybody stressed, but I hope you can find some comfort whether in these videos or whatever you find comfort in. I hope you all have a lovely day or night where you're at. This is LevDev, signing out. A bada beep, a bada boop.